Thank you, Laura, for that very thoughtful introduction. I'd also like to thank Dr. Naylor and the World War I Museum, as well as Woody and Ward of the COSAD company for giving me the opportunity to speak to you today. I think whenever we view the past, we've got to keep a very open mind, but also we should be very hesitant to judge rather quickly, to be too critical. Hindsight is always 20/20, and I think one of the biggest topics of criticism of the Monday morning quarterback syndrome occurs during World War I. So before we begin, I'd like to all of you to clear your minds for a moment and just imagine, again, 1915, the United States, or 2015, however you'd like, whatever year you'd really like. Hypothetically speaking, imagine this scenario occurs. Mexico invades the United States with overwhelming military superiority, massive land invasion, huge armies that move in, big swath of territory, shooting all the way across Texas, towards Santa Fe, across Phoenix, and into Southern California. We respond, but what happens when the line is drawn is the Mexicans are fully dug in, and they have established a very strong formation along parts of the Colorado River, the Rio Grande, and along and down the Red River. Southern California gone, our naval base at San Diego, almost all of Arizona and New Mexico, as well as a massive amount of Texas. A huge part of our territory has been conquered by Mexico. Not only that, a lot of our economy, a lot of our people in particular, we start to instantly and very quickly hear stories of violent oppression, forced labor, conscription, women being killed, men being carted off. Perhaps these partisan attacks are justified or not, but we have enemy boots on our territory. What do we do? What would we do? What would you do? Would we just stand idly by? What was the response here? What's at stake? What is at stake for us? This is exactly what France, in particular, not only Belgium and England in Great Britain, but especially France faces in 1915. What are they looking at? They are looking at a large part of their territory. As we can see, all of Belgium is basically gone. We have one little sliver left where the BEF, the British Expeditionary Force, holding the line around Ypres. This is prime real estate in northeastern France. More or less, you have 50 to 60% of France's textiles, coal, iron ore, industry, right in this area. 14% of its industrial population. So you're looking at a 40% decrease in France's pre-war economic capability, especially military capability. And it gets much worse because just like that scenario I painted for you in world for the United States, the same exact thing is going on. You quickly have, I think, Ray Marquer's Dutch artist, his cartoons, very anti-German at the time, really bring that out. As we really start to see with the work of Alistair Horn and more recent scholarship, especially by French historians like Annette Becker, Germany, this is not a kind occupier. It was oppressive, it was strong, it was ruthless. Excuse me. So here's one last image from Raymaker I'd like to leave with you here. You see, and this is the case, we have the wife, the children begging with the Germans as the husband is taken away. This is a reality. Men are being taken away for forced labor. This is particularly happens in 1915, especially as the year progresses. So that's our scenario. How do we react to this? This is what the French have to face, what the British, the Belgians. This is the Western Front. After this Christmas truce in 1914, there quickly is that's over. This is January 1915. This is what the Allies are left with. But I want to focus particularly on the French, but I really want to cover all sides, so I'll focus on Germany, France, and Britain as well. When you think of 1915, you probably, or you think of World War I, 1915 is probably the last year that comes to mind. 1914, of course, massive movements of the armies, the Schlieffen Plan almost taking Paris, France almost falls, but the Allies hold the line and it stabilizes. I'm sure you also think of 1916 before you think of 1915. The great, this is a wonderful propaganda poster in the background there, "They shall not pass." France's amazing stand at Verdun. Of course, the Somme as well. These two titanic battles, which I'm sure next year at our symposium will be discussed in detail. Epic, epic, month long, almost in duration of the year. Perhaps you'd also think before 1915, think of 1917, the collapse of Russia and the rise of the Russian Revolution and Vladimir Lenin. Or the entrance of America, 6 April 1917. Or for Canadians and the British, Passchendaele, this absolute quagmire, this mass of mud and water. Or I'm sure you'd quickly think of 1918 and the AAF coming to the aid and tipping the balance for the Allies and the victory. This is in New York and the closure of the war. And even if you do think of 1915, you probably think Lusitania, perhaps a major event, or the Dardanelles and the Gallipoli campaign. So more than likely, when you think about World War I, Western Front 1915 is probably one of the last things that springs to mind. However, I would argue that while it is not the decisive year of the war, it is the definitive year of the war. Because in 1915, we see exactly what is going to happen. It's going to set that tone. It's going to set the table for the rest of the war. Rather than kind of giving you a blow-by-blow account of all the combat, I'll just quickly surmise the situation between our three great powers on the Western Front, Germany, France, and Great Britain. So what was the strategic situation for Germany? Well, one thing to really keep in mind is whenever you're fighting in a combat situation like this and you have this kind of concentric circle, it's always easier, regardless if it's World War I or not, to defend because your lines, your interior lines, are shorter. So Germany's at an advantage because this is exactly what Germany's going to do in 1915. With the exception of attacking here, right at Ypres, the Second Battle of Ypres, and also right in here in the Argonne, but that's not a major offensive. Other than that, Germany's on the defensive. France, on the other hand, is naturally going to take that offensive stand because what else could they do? Just sit there? The commander Joffre is under very strong pressure because the government has moved back to Paris from Bordeaux, so the government is much more involved in military affairs. Get these German boots off our soil. So, strategic situation for the Germans. We'll start with the great von Falkenhayn. He is the commander in the west of the German army. He's a very capable commander. What happens with him is he knows that the west is the way to victory. However, he loses 8 divisions, and this is key. He loses a battle between these two men, von Hindenburg and Ludendorff. The two German generals in the east, they are still riding the coattails of their amazing success at Tannenberg in 1914. They are very well connected and very popular. They have good political connections. They really feel the war is in the east. Falkenhayn loses, and these 8 divisions are crucial. They are transferred to the east. They will continue to win favor of Kaiser Wilhelm II until eventually Falkenhayn is replaced by this dynamic duo. So really what Falkenhayn is left with is a matter of 8 less divisions and much more interest in the east. So the only major offensive he will do is in Second Battle of Ypres. Let's turn to the French. General Papa Joffre, very much a staunch believer in that very traditional kind of French military mindset, very Napoleonic. Attack, attack, attack. That's what he writes to his commanders. We must bring it to the enemy. We must attack. We must defeat them. This is very important because he's under stress, not only from his government, not only from himself, but also a sense of responsibility, a sense of honor. We have to help the Russians because right now, as Dr. Stone really pointed out, the Russians are losing huge swaths of territory. They are being defeated and defeated. Germany has had a string of victories as the year progresses. So Joffre's going to launch offensive after offensive, two major ones, one in the spring and one in the autumn. Massive offensives that cost thousands of lives. Joffre's other main commander, who will eventually replace him, is Ferdinand Foch, and Foch is of the same exact mindset of Joffre. It's really a sense of the offense. The offense has to win. Because think about it, what is really the alternative for France? What's the alternative in 1915? We've seen the map, Germany has occupied us. What do we do? We have to take the fight to them if they're going to sit there. Here are the two talking in unison, and there is a large agreement. There is, however, very big conflict between these two men with these two gentlemen here that Joffre is flanked by, Sir John French and his successor in December of 1915, Sir Douglas Haig. French did not get along well with the French. We have to remember, too, the Anglo-French alliance is shaky. This is a very historic rivalry. The Hundred Years' War, the Seven Years' War, French and Indian War, American Revolution, the French Revolution, Napoleonic Wars. These are not brothers. There's much more, as we know, if you look at the Queen Victoria's lineage, you put a picture of George V and the Tsar and Wilhelm next to each other, and there are very striking similarities. So Sir John French is going to be of the idea that what else can we really do? We want to fight independently. The French, Joffre, is putting immense pressure on the British. Help. We need help. Back me up. Let's do a combined offensive, massive offensive. We have to keep in mind the British army is almost non-existent. They were devastated in 1914. They're extremely small, and we now have Kitchener trying to build his army. And there will be a million volunteers during the course of 1915 as Kitchener raises this new army, but the British need time. And Sir John French is very reluctant to go along with French ideas. He does resign some fights, though, to Sir Douglas Haig, in particular that of Neuve Chapelle. And what Haig takes is from General Henry Laurenson's idea of what he calls the bite and hold. I'd like you to really remember that, because this is really basically what 1915 is all about. The French are going to do kind of a similar idea, but for Joffre, it's much more of the decisive battle, looking for that absolute classic knockout blow. That's what he's looking for. Crush the Germans with overwhelming blunt force trauma. But the British can't do such large-scale attacks, so it's really this, again, this concept used by Haig, developed by Rawlinson, the bite and hold. Take a small chunk and try to hold on to it, wait for the Germans to counter. The British were very good at that bite, but the hold is the problem, and it wasn't a problem with the British, it was more of a problem with just the nature of the war. So great poster here. In the meantime, this is what the British is more concerned with, is trying to rebuild that army. Also keep in mind, too, we're in the Dardanelles with Sir Winston Churchill's plan of the genesis of that plan to go find that other front, help Russia. Again, it's very much, Thucydides was right 2,500 years ago when he argued that what really are wars fought about? Yeah, there's fear, there's interest, but it's really honor. And that's really weighing on the Allies at this point. We've got to help the Russians. They mobilized and they fought when they had to. They honored their commitment. We need to help the Russians because they will fall. There's a real fear that they're going to fall without our aid. So the BEF is slowly trying to rebuild, France keeping stress on them, wanting to the offensive, and Falkenhayn, Germans just biding their time, trying to also assess Falkenhayn losing those eight divisions, thinking, do I really even need to attack? And he will again at Ypres. Something else that really I'd like to stress that we, I believe, take for granted in 2015 is the air war, the third dimension of warfare. I think for us, with hindsight, we just, the B-52s and the campaigns of shock and awe during the Iraq war, really just the Hellfire missiles fired from RPAs, you have this very easy concept of air war is part of life. But think about it. It's in its infancy. And what I'd like to show here is a map, and you can see from all of these, what's going to happen is we're going to get the first blitz. Even before the bombing, the strategic bombing campaigns of World War II, Germany was already trying, even as early as April, these are all the major attacks in 1915 on London raids, but Germany is already bombing England in April of 1915. And you note, too, the important thing is look where a lot of the bases are located. There's one in France, and there are quite a few in Belgium. More impetus, more strain of they're on foreign soil, they're on Belgian and French territory using attacks to attack England. A lot of the air bases as well for airplanes will be in these two areas as well as the air war increases. Now the Zeppelin, again, they seem to us these lumbering, slow behemoths. This is LZ-38, the first airship that's going to actually attack London in 31 May. And these are incendiary bombs, and you can see, too, a lot of them didn't really do what they're supposed to. They didn't detonate. But just think about that. This is something we've never seen before, and the British people are seeing something quite fearful, incendiary bombs that spread fire. Here are some pictures, firemen putting it out, the blazes from the very first raid, again, in April of 1915 at Bury St. Edmunds. And here we have some pictures of London. Some of these actually, I think if you quickly look, you'd think they were from 1940, from the actual Blitz, from the battle for Britain. So even in 1915, with just Zeppelins, the Germans kill almost 200 British civilians, injure more than double that, and do 42 raids. So there is this sense of we've got to do something. Germany has still got this fantastic reach, devastating parts of our country. Two propaganda posters I like to share with you that I think really drive home that point. It's far better to face bullets than be killed at home by a bomb. So really the sense of we've got to do something, they're taking the fight to us, and what are we going to do about that? How are we going to take the fight to Germany? Another great poster, Men of Britain, will you stand for this? With a small little girl and a baby, and really stressing just those points. Besides the Zeppelin, though, this is the very first year we did see airplanes were invented by the Wright brothers, but they couldn't be sold to the U.S. Army, so they took their trade to Europe. And very quickly, this is not in 1915, this is later, but in 1915, two important things happen that really begin that air war, that classic dogfight that we see in 16, 17, 18, those great, amazing, romantic battles of these knights of the air. And it's by this man, Roland Garros, who first has the idea to put the machine guns right with the propeller. He puts deflector on, and everyone thinks he's crazy, but it works. He unfortunately is shot down, and the Germans get a hold of some of his technology. And it's this man, a Dutchman, actually by birth, he is Anton Fokker. He's the one who actually takes Garros's idea and develops the synchronizer. So by April, you've got that very, very classic rat-a-tat-tat, the dogfighting war has begun. And it's again, not really until the later years, but this is where it starts. Planes are used for observation, they start to be used for bombing, but they are continually going to become more and more important. How do we hear the planes? Trying to listen, some of the great color photos, there's quite a few of them actually. Trying to hear those observer planes. Because that's the key is, think about this, 400 mile front. How do you know what's really out there? Well, the observation planes help pretty well, and this is what they see. Tough to really assess. It's very dangerous. These planes are not very good. if you get a little closer, this is what the trenches look like. They're not just straightforward. They're well done. And as early as December of 1914, the Germans already realize this is not open movement. This is not movement warfare. This is positional warfare. They start to dig in. They start mining. They start digging in very strongly. The Germans are going to lead the way always with their trench system. So quickly, even by January of 1915, we've already got pretty good trenches. This is a little bit later on, but it shows you a good of kind of the makeshift trench. He's got the Blue Horizon uniform, which is quickly going to replace. In April, the French start to put on these uniforms, the Blue Horizon, rather than the very Napoleonic bright red trousers, which act as a wonderful target. And he also has the Adrian helmet, which looks like the fireman's helmet, which will be also phased in 1915. So even these are from 1915, this is the trenches you already start to have. Very sophisticated, very well dug in, sandbags, wood, they're strong, they're excellent. This is the view that this gentleman was looking at. That is open ground, so if the enemy's dug in, how do we take the enemy? How do we defeat the enemy? We have to cross this. We have to cross this open ground and try to attack the enemy and defeat him. And you'll notice, too, we start to get one of the most famous defense capabilities of the Western Front, which is barbed wire. Tons and tons and tons of it, and more and more and more as the war progresses. Here's a really great shot, is how the heck do you destroy all that? How do you get through all that? George Marshall of World War II fame would later estimate in 1917 that it took 500 shrapnel artillery rounds to take out a 5x10 meter piece of barbed wire. 500 rounds, and that's only a 5x10 space. So even if you do just that, all I have to do is just train my machine guns to that point. And it just ducks in a barrel. It's a turkey shoot. This is from early 1916, a British Vickers machine gun, but we'll talk about gas in a little bit because it's really going to make its premiere as well in 1915. But the machine gun is not a tool that takes a lot of skill. You just literally have to just go back and forth. Here is a German 1915 field manual. It shows how A, you can sit in the kneeling position, you can quickly pull it down to prone, and then C, picking it up to carry it. This is very difficult, this is very heavy. This is an MG-08, the classic Maxim German machine gun. A very strong man it would take to actually do this, but it could be done. The machine gun is mobile. So when we are trying to charge that enemy trench, we're faced with a very mobile opponent. And it gets much worse. Here's another piece of a nice illustration from a German field manual. Zug is the German word for train, but also for platoon. So we have our three machine gun platoons, and you can see the fire, how it loses its accuracy, but look what it does, it widens. So we have this amazing, huge swath that we're covering with four machine guns, there are six actually, we're covering a huge amount of territory. So we can't simply just rush at this, especially when barbed wire is there over rough terrain. These trenches are dug in deep. This is one of my favorites, though, to really illustrate the power of the machine gun and what the commanders are facing in 1915. This is actually from a French field manual. And what it's showing here, we have C12 Ohm, the French word for man. At 800 meters, so about almost 900 yards, the 12-to-1 ratio, one soldier with a rifle could bring down to parity 12 men at 800 meters. With a machine gun, even if he holds out till 300 meters, he can take down 14, a 14-to-1 ratio, one machine gunner. That shows you the power of the defensive. What do you do? How are we going to possibly break that deadlock? How are we going to lift that? Especially when the terrain looks like this. We can try to shoot artillery, but there's so many pockets. Here we have a German sentry guarding these trenches, hiding everywhere. The terrain is difficult to see over. Even with the plane, with observing, we just don't know. It's changing every day. Even Sir Douglas Haig would note, he was asking for after-action reports in 1915. One of the things he really stressed to his commanders was, you should be viewing the Western Front on a daily basis, because it keeps changing. The enemy's always moving. It's mobile, and it's deadly. And the trenches are getting stronger and stronger and stronger. Even at night, it's difficult. This is a great Nash painting. You have the illumination at night, so that makes even trying to attack in the evening difficult. Here's a great chart from 1915 as well. This is a British field manual from 1915. Look what you see. Here's our front with lots of barbed wire, our front trench, our support trench, and another support, communication trench. They're all intertwined. This is defense in depth. That's the key, defense in depth. So remember that bite and hold. If we can even make it to that front trench, how do we hold that? We're exhausted. We're severely outnumbered now because it's all about the counter. This is the problem. We could take perhaps that first trench, but the hard part is holding it from that counterstroke that's coming. And the Germans were excellent at this, again and again and again. This is what we see in 1915. Even with the big spring and autumn offensives by Joffre, this is exactly what we see. The British and the French can get in, but they just can't hold it. The artillery is very difficult to synchronize artillery with the actual infantry. The artillery can stick to the timetable, but it's hard for the infantry to do so. But they weren't fools. Here's another great 1915 British infantry manual. You can see we're not attacking head on here. We're coming from this side. These are grenadiers, grenade throwers. We have some bayonet men, almost to the point of stormtroop tactics, what Falkenhayn started to ask for as early as February of 1915, using shock troops to come in, probe, weaken, exploit. We are continually trying to find ways, how do we break that deadlock? And see here again, we come in from the side, from the flank, and then we have sandbag men, actually. These spare men are going to put sandbags here to start to actually counterbalance and defend against the counterattack that is definitely coming. You can also see the underground tunnel. Sapping became extremely, extremely important to both sides. Once again, it's the Germans that start it in December of 1914. And by 1915, it is almost everywhere, almost on every front. There's counter-sapping. Sapping, these miners are digging. If you've read the novel or seen the film Birdsong, it's a very good depiction of exactly how intense these mining operations are. They're dangerous not only just naturally, but also you've got the enemy digging. How can we break the deadlock? Above the ground, under it, on top of it. This is actually from a captured German plan that the British took. This is autumn 1915. You can already see what is the most fearful thing really of the Western Front is the pillbox, reinforced concrete. The Germans are already experimenting with it and reinforcing all of their trenches by as early as autumn 1915. And let me tell you, there's nothing, if you know construction, you know when you start putting rebar in concrete, it is almost indestructible. You'd need a 120-pound jackhammer to really make a dent. So when a French 75-millimeter cannon hits one of these, it's not going to do much. This is what they really look like. This is later in the war, but this is what we're going to get. 1915, these start. In particular, this is a nice shot in 1915 of the Argonne. Brutal fighting, back and forth fighting. The Germans are going to hold on to big parts of the Argonne. They're going to look just like this here. And this is what the AEF, the Doughboys, are going to face in 1918, a very well dug in opponent. So the big thing is, well, we'll just try artillery. And this is what most of the commanders are thinking, especially Joffre in particular, the British as well. But as Dr. Stone was really stressing, the same problem that the Russians had, you better believe that the French and the British are having it as well. All of the ammunition is depleted. The French, as we saw, most of their industrial capacity is taken. You have the rest of the country working 24/7 trying to produce shells. Unfortunately, this produces a lot of poor shells. The France in particular in 1915 are prone to exploding shells, which destroy the breech of the barrels. So when we have massive guns like this, the idea is, well, we'll throw 10,000, we'll throw 20,000 shells at them. They'll break, eventually they'll break. Now the problem is when you use guns of this caliber, heavy guns, which the French were always in need of, you turn, this is Ypres actually, at the end of 1915, you turn the landscape into a mess, a destroyed, devastated mess. These are all shots from Ypres, some color shots here as well. So this is just what it does to the city, but most importantly is what it does to everyone else. Besides the rounds there from the high explosive rounds, the big one is the shrapnel, which actually is better at breaking up the barbed wire. Because when you hit it with a high explosive round, it usually will just throw the barbed wire up and falls back to the ground. But remember that stat from Marshall was pretty accurate. It takes an immense amount of shells, especially shrapnel or high explosive, more with high explosive shells, to get rid of that barbed wire. But if we bomb and bomb and bomb, and here's what the shrapnel explodes when it comes in, if we bomb and bomb and bomb the area, here's a great picture of it from the ground up, what happens to that area is this. It's just, it becomes a mess. So trying to get our troops through there is extremely difficult. You've made this immense quagmire, huge pools, especially in the marshy fields of France and Flanders. It's a mess. And most of the wire is, unfortunately, if it's gone, it's still there. It's still difficult to traverse. This is before the tank. There are some rumblings of it, in particular in 1915 from the French again, trying to come up with some kind of armored vehicle. And it'll be the British in 1916. But again, in 1915, we have, these are some of the brilliant minds of military prowess, engineers, strategists, trying to come up. They're not sitting idly by just thinking, which became vogue really, especially in the 1960s, about they're just donkeys and they're leading lions. That, for the most part, really is not the case. These are men, and it doesn't excuse the death, but these are men trying to come up with an idea of how do we break the deadlock? How do we break it? Massive artillery, massive assault. They've got to break eventually. And again, it's very hard for us to wrap our minds around that because 2020 hindsight, it's very easy to point a finger and judge and break down. Well, they should have done that. Should have done that. You get into kind of the counterfactual history. It's very easy to point, well, if he only did this or that. So this is what you're left with. Huge mess, really, is what it is. Mud. Dirt everywhere. In particular, too, this is a great close-up of it. Just try to get troops through that. Even if they're able to slog up, again, get ready for the counterattack, which is what German was so good at. They were always able to come to that aid. Also, the bodies, most of them could not be taken out. So you can imagine just the moral impact of that, seeing all of your comrades, or just bodies in general, trying to get over that. The no man's land was a brutal place in 1915 already. There's a great stat chart in our in your booklets there, really showing the amount of casualties. France sustains 143,000 by the end of the war, by the end of 1915. Devastated on all accounts. Germany, not as much, because they're always on the defensive. So France continually losing and losing men. And Joffre just keeps thinking, maybe one more will break them. We've got to do something. They're on the ropes. And these are a little bit later, but you see the problem. Okay, well, we've taken something. We've taken a point. Now we need to move the artillery up. We need to reposition the artillery. We need to move up. We need to advance. That's the difficult thing, is how do you, we can take territory, but how do we hold it? That's the key, because that counter is going to come. And when it comes, it's going to be brutal. Men trying to do it, well, we'll try with horses, just as difficult. Most horses from World War I, they didn't actually die from wounds, they actually died from exhaustion. Horses aren't meant to pull this kind of weight, especially heavy artillery. Their heart eventually will give out. They were used in great numbers, of course, trying to transport goods, caked in mud, trying to take care of them as best as they can. There's a donkey who's covered in mud here. The artillery shells fired are beyond recognition as how many they've been firing, thousands and thousands. In particular, there's one other kind of shell I'd like to focus on, as we saw from last time. It really makes its premiere. Now, the French used grenades that had tear gas in 1914. The Germans experimented with it as well, but it's actually in 1915 at the Second Battle of Ypres that the Germans first use with Falkenhayn's big, only really true offensive in the Western Front in 1915. 22 April 1915, first day of the Second Battle of Ypres, Falkenhayn has, led by the Nobel Prize winner, Fritz Haber, he personally oversees the release of over 5,000 cylinders of chlorine gas. But Falkenhayn didn't believe in the gas. He said, it's not going to do much. And Germany lost a really great opportunity to try to continue to push. The gas, of course, shocks the French, in particular a colonial division as well as some territorial guard. These are older French troops, and they flee in panic. And General Mordoc sees this, and he can't believe the reports coming in. He sees these men fleeing, choking, grabbing their throats, crying, coughing up blood. And it's actually in particular at St. Julien where the Canadians and some other French troops are able to hold the line and just take this gas. But this is a later propaganda poster that really shows how important gas becomes, but it really is not the war-winning weapon that both sides were thinking of. The Germans get blamed very quickly, too, for being the brutes, the nasty Huns, but you better believe that the French and British quickly, after 22 April, quickly decide to, what do they got there? Let's check it out. By the end of the year, the French in the Second Champagne Offensive in the fall, as well as the British at Loos, are both using gas. And it'll quickly become one of the most dominating factors, really most popular shells used. By the end of the war, late 1918, you've got about 20 to 30% of all shells being fired are gas shells. And of course, the gas is going to get even more and more lethal. First chlorine, phosgene, and different variants of phosgene, the big one, the most famous being mustard gas, first used again by the Germans. Brutal because it not only does it attack the lungs, it also will burn any exposed skin, particularly the eyes, which we see from this famous photo, also done very powerfully by Sargent's painting entitled Gas. It's a long line of British soldiers being blinded by the mustard gas. Here the AEF actually in 1918, fully embracing chemical warfare, but they were going to lean heavily on the French for their supplies. So this is really the picture I'd like to focus on just for a moment, is really trying to think, maybe in our Q&A we could, because it's really the question of 1915, but really the overall, the bigger question of the war is how do you break that deadlock? Could it really be done? Was there a way for the Allies, the French in particular, to reclaim that territory? Could they do it? Was it possible? Because that's exactly what they were trying. There's that sense of obligation. Joffre felt that if we sit here, the troops are going to lose the morale. We have to attack. We have to maintain the offensive. We must maintain the initiative. Anyone, any logical commander would want to maintain the initiative. Better to dictate to the enemy, just like in a game of chess, better to dictate to the enemy, you control the game, you control the battle. Joffre tries to do that again and again. And he maintains power, maintains popularity, even with these major defeats in 1915. The biggest two, though, again, are here in this area. He launches two major offensives in the spring and fall. Both meet some success at first, but they can't maintain that success. The British are going to attack mainly, the big one will be here at Neuve Chapelle, but then also at Loos. Those are again in the spring and the fall. Smaller offensives, because the British are very weakened. They're focusing on the Dardanelles and the Gallipoli campaign. But again, that bite and hold. We can take it, but we can't hold it. And that's the problem they continually face. Whereas the Germans Falkenhayn, he just really, for the most part, with the exception of Ypres, is on the defensive. He doesn't need to really do much. And most historians would argue that Germany lets go of the advantage, lets go of the initiative, but I would argue it's really the other way around, because you've got all of this territory and you could just sit there. And we see how difficult it is to maintain the offensive in World War I. It really is a conundrum of how do you get around that. So I think before we quickly kind of judge the commanders of the Great War, we should always take a look exactly at what they were facing. Because it's so easy, again, with hindsight, to really say, yes, what were they thinking? And by no means is it to overlook the amount of casualties, and you've got that great chart again in your booklets to really show that. Hundreds of thousands dead, two times that at least wounded in 1915 alone. And it would be this year in particular that will set the tone for how artillery is used, how the infantry is used, the air war itself. And in particular, how do we break that? Joff is going to decide, well, those offensives didn't work, so we'll try an even bigger one. But this time, and he has a meeting right before Christmas in a chateau in December, he has a big meeting with the Allies, and he says, we need to coordinate our attacks. The British are in agreement, because now Sir John French has been axed. On 6 December, he is fired, and Sir Douglas Haig is promoted. So now Douglas Haig is in charge of the BEF. They decide together. The big, of course, will be up in the Somme. And that will change, though, because Falkenhayn has his own plan. He really sees, we need to take the initiative now. Now's our time. After really, for the most part, the Germany has really won in 1915. They feel, Falkenhayn especially feels, he focuses on Verdun. That's certainly a story for next year's conference. But he's going to decide to take to the offensive, bleed the French white, as he says. And he's going to build up to do just that. So as we kind of reflect, I'd like to really go over and sum up 1915 in the words of a German soldier, Max Barthel, who in his Storm in the Argonne Forest was kind of a quasi-memoir in a way, written several decades later. He was in the Argonne in 1915. He fought against the French. I'd like to focus on this quote for a minute. The war had long since altered its appearance. No longer were there mounted attacks, helmet plumes blowing, spear points and swords gleaming in the sunlight. There were no colors or standards fluttering in the ranks. The colors wore were now gray, blue, black, and red. Gray and blue horizon were the uniforms, blue, black, the steel and powder smoke, and red for the gouts of flame and blood. Instead of trumpeters, there was a howl of shells, with one single direct hit having greater power than an entire company storming forward in earlier times. I can't think of a better quote that encapsulates the Great War, and in particular 1915, because it is that definitive year that will set the pace for the rest of the war. It really, truly was a time when the commanders faced a conflict that they were not prepared for. They did their best in some ways to try to over, most of them did try to come up with new ways to try to break the deadlock. And they just weren't prepared for the killing power of the machine gun, of the artillery. But they did indeed, as I've tried to really flesh out, trying to come up with ways, and it doesn't exclude the casualties. But I think before we're quick to judge them, we should really, again, try to, or anyone, put ourselves in those shoes and ask ourselves just that question. First, what would we do, going with that hypothetical scenario, what would we do if we were invaded and we lost that much territory and we knew our civilians were being oppressed? What would we do? How would we counter? Because it really comes down to a question of honor. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen.
I would invite you to come down to audio microphone. There is another one on the other side for questions.
So there's a lot of questions or a lot of criticism about the mistakes that were made.
Oh, sure.
in 1915. In your research, in your studies, if you look at this, what impressed you about the French response?
About the French response in 1915?
What stood out to you as moments of clarity, moments of brilliance, moments of resilience?
Well, I think, again, for me personally, I would say that the idea of really trying to take, I'm just speaking for me personally, and that's why I start with kind of trying to put ourselves in the French shoes, is we've got to try to break the deadlock. And while an offensive seems like, again, I can't think of an alternate scenario to trying to defeat the Germans. If they're on the territory, how else could we possibly do that? So in hindsight, with the, and it doesn't excuse the amount of death at all, but in hindsight, it's easier to judge. But again, I think just, I can't think of another way than the offensive. And it's not to say that we shouldn't learn lessons from those conflicts or what the French did. But other than trying to defeat the Germans, then you just sit there and you do nothing. So I wouldn't say brilliance. Brilliance is, I think, a very strong word, so I don't think there was any brilliance, actually. But again, I'm hard-pressed to find really an alternate scenario and of what we would do, how we would react to having so much territory taken. And it's, I think you really only have two choices. It's really, it's a question of when a bully pushes you, you either push back or you be prepared to get pummeled. So that's really what it comes down to.
I hope I'm not being repetitive with this question. You bring up a very intriguing point about, you know, judging in hindsight, but I guess I'm really curious if you would just give an opinion on Douglas Haig and his tactics.
Oh, yeah. is the most controversial figure.
Yeah, I just wanted to extract that from you.
Just to be the devil's advocate, in 1915, he is one of the individuals who starts to request after-action reports in 1915. And if you really do read them, as I mentioned just that one point about studying the terrain on a daily basis, he's got a lot of good points about how we can try to defeat this enemy, exploiting gaps, trying to take advantage, not maybe a frontal assault. There's ideas there. Again, I'm not trying to defend any of these men. I just think it's so easy to judge. Again, that kind of Monday morning quarterback. It doesn't excuse any of the amount of death, but at the same time, I don't think any of these men, not all of them, of course, I'm sure there were some who just didn't care about the loss and just take the objective. I mean, that's very much, if you watch Paths of Glory with Kirk Douglas there, or read the book, you get that sense. And that's still really popular. I mean, even in the film Birdsong, you see the generals just, they don't care about the men. And of course there were individuals like that. But I think collectively we have to see that they're still trying to do the best they can. I think I would liken it to General Lee, third day of Gettysburg, very much criticized again. What was he thinking? But it's like a gambler. You're so low in the hole. Ugh, but just with one more hand, maybe I can get it back. You got to take that risk, because that's really what it's all about. And I think that's really what I would liken it to. It's just one more shot. If I just play one more hand, they might break. Certainly, what Lee is thinking, going across that open territory. It's very easy to criticize Lee, but it was close. And if he had won, we would be saying something, I'm sure, entirely different.
And our last question will come from the other side.
I'm still in the same vein. And by the way, I did meet Kirk Douglas, and he said Paths of Glory was his favorite movie.
Wait, it's got to be the Germans now. I have to defend the Germans?
No, it's about, I'm sorry, the biggest question I had is, okay, so I'm Sir John Frank, or I'm Douglas Haig, or I'm Foch, or I'm, you know. I said, we don't have a weapon to break the French system. So why should we waste our men? Why don't we go to the Balkans and beat up the Austro-Hungarians and beat them that way? Or
right.
Let's go to Gallipoli. Let's finish that job. So you see what I mean? It's like the generals go to the politicians and we don't have a weapon to beat the system. Let's hold off until we do.
Right. that actually is a great point, and I think you're getting fundamentally at one of the most complex conundrums in life. And I'll defer to Clausewitz here with his really his trinity. You've got the civilians, the military commanders, and the politicians. And it's very, very uneasy relationship. And it's one that continually is being pulled and swayed by each other. And it's the politicians demanding this of the military saying, well, what else can I do? And the civilians also kind of thrown in the middle. So it's a great point, and I think this is the problem we face throughout history. And Clausewitz had it right, and it's difficult to overcome. And as Clausewitz also said, the plans go out the window with the first contact with the enemy. So I don't think it really has an answer, but it's part of the human condition.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.